So, I've recently been shooting pretty much everything with my Canon EOS R. This mirrorless camera has now become, it's now kind of become my primary camera for nearly everything. And one of these things is video. And my current video setup is as follows. Of course, the gimbal is a super important part of my video making process. It's what essentially gets my shots looking really smooth. I get some really nice movements, and then I can eventually turn that in post. I can add some really nice transitions and make a really cool video, kind of like what you saw in the intro. Before I even get into the gimbal itself, let me give you guys just a very brief rundown. Okay, not a brief rundown, but a rundown of my video making settings, my camera video making settings, just for those who maybe have absolutely no idea where to start with videos, with the video and the video settings, and kind of just to get their bearings, basically. Now, the first thing I'll do when I want to record something in slow motion, for example, or something with a bit more slow motion, the first thing I'll do is I'll change my camera settings first from photo to video, which like seems a very stupid point, but the amount of times when I was first starting video, I was like, okay, what do I do? How do I do it? Because I had never really shot video before. Change from photo to video. I know it sounds dumb, but sometimes you forget to do it, and yeah, there you go. After which I changed to video. The next thing I'll do is I'll go into manual, and I usually select manual because of one reason. I get full control of nearly everything. Actually, full control of everything. I get full control of ISO. I get my full control of temperature change, my white balance. I get full control of my aperture, and I get full control of my shutter speed, which is really important, especially when you're shooting stuff like, I don't know, real estates, or if you're shooting things like different rooms, or you're introducing subjects into the frame. Things are continuously moving. It's important to have full control of like pretty much everything that you can. Selecting manual is actually very important because it'll allow you to play around with the settings and to understand how your camera works in video mode, and most importantly, to achieve the correct exposure. The second most important thing that I tend to do once I'm in manual is adjust my frame rate or change my frame rate. And basically, if you don't know what frame rate is, I'll explain it to you in a nutshell. Frame rate is the amount of frames that your camera can capture, the amount of individual frames that your camera can capture per second. So a higher frame rate is something like 60 frames per second. 60 frames per second is what I'd usually select if I want to start to do things in slow motion or to record things that will eventually become slow motion. Something like 24 or 25 frames per second is what you're seeing right now, and it's what I'm recording at right now. Frame rate is super important because it influences what will eventually become or translate into slow motion during the editing process. So when I have my footage shot in 60 frames per second, I can then take that footage, put it into Premiere Pro, and then reduce that even further. I usually have 60 frames per second selected more often than not because I'm usually recording B-roll, my supplementary footage to what you're seeing now. So in between what I'm explaining, you'll see a video of my camera, or you'll see a video of me with the SD card, like in my previous video. So yeah, the 60 frames a second is what I'd use to record my supplementary footage. What I strongly recommend first timers doing, if you're looking at upgrading to a better video camera, specifically for video, is to check up to what frame rate can the camera that you're looking at purchasing record. Reason being is that the frame rate will eventually determine how many pixels you can record in. For example, the Canon EOS R, the camera that I'm using right now to record this video, can shoot at 25, I believe, 25 frames per second at 1920 by 1080 pixels. That's the standard that pretty much everyone that uploads to YouTube does and records in, because it's full HD. However, as soon as I change to 60 frames per second, it's reduced to 1920 by 720 pixels. This will hugely influence the quality resolution of the video itself. So that was what I'd do if I would record it 60 frames per second. However, if I'm just creating a regular YouTube video and I just want to have the camera on the tripod and I want to record myself like I'm doing right now, I'd just change it from 60 to 25 frames per second, and there you go. And then I've got full HD 1920 by 1080 and I'm ready to record. Okay, enough of that. It's time to set up the gimbal. Now, as you can see, I've got quite a bit of equipment in front of me. At the minute, it's not in focus, but don't worry, it will be as soon as I start explaining what parts and how to set up and how to put things together, etc. But I remember the first time I bought this gimbal and I had absolutely no idea what I was doing. I did pretty much the thing that everyone does when they don't know what they're doing, and that's go on YouTube and research how do I set up this gimbal because I have a particular model. How do I attach the base plate? How do I do this? How do I put the batteries in? So on and so forth. And it's a pretty intimidating piece of equipment. It's not as easy as I thought it was going to be. I ran into quite a few complications, especially the fact that I wanted to use my Canon EOS R. I had to buy a very specific adapter. A bunch of problems. But as soon as I started to use it, the more I started to use it, the more comfortable I felt with it, and then it became a breeze. So if you're new to gimbal usage and you've just bought a gimbal or you're thinking about investing, it doesn't have to be this make or model. My one, just for argument's sake, my one is the Moser Air 2, which is a pretty good gimbal. However, if you're thinking about investing in a gimbal piece and you have absolutely no idea where to start, hopefully you can apply the way I set up this one to the one that you're thinking about buying or the one that you already have. The thing I do, obviously, is take out my gimbal equipment. Here you'll see the main gimbal itself. For the purposes of this gimbal setup, I'm going to be using my old camera, the Canon 7D, this one right here. Then you have your batteries, and then you have Moser actually provides this tiny little thing right here, which is really, really convenient, and it helps, and it basically helps to screw on the base plate here, which is really, really handy. It's really cool. You don't have to use a coin or anything. And then you have finally the attachment where this slides onto here, and then that eventually the camera goes on there, and then your gimbal, this hooks onto the gimbal at the very end. So the first thing that I usually do when I have a gimbal of this size is I get the gimbal up and I grab my tripod. Now, my gimbal has a tripod. If you don't have a mounted tripod for your gimbal, then you're gonna have to do this facing down with the gimbal exactly how it is. But the first thing that I wanna do is hook on the batteries. And I like to hook on the batteries with the gimbal facing upright because it's more convenient for me and it's much easier to handle it that way. And you wanna add your batteries in, you want to add your batteries in every time that you use the gimbal, and what I do is I take it out every time that I don't use the gimbal and I have it packed away. Now, once the batteries are set up, you're going to want to add this cover back in straight away. There you go, and you'll hear sort of like a little click, and then it should be all good. The next thing that I tend to do is the camera with the base plate mount. So the camera with the base plate, this is where this tiny little thing comes in super handy. And I'll just attach it like I normally do if I was to hook it on a tripod. So once that's screwed on pretty tight, I usually tighten it quite a bit. I make sure it's nice in line. And I'll get this and I'll slide it until I hear a click. There you go, the final click. And then the last thing that you want to do here, or that I do with my gimbal, is that there's a lock function, which is really, really cool. It means that everything is nice and secure. I lock it in place. The final stage, of course, is to attach the gimbal, to attach the camera to the gimbal, and to calibrate it. And this can take a little bit of work. if you're a first-time user. I remember it took me a little while until I can actually get all the rotations perfectly balanced before I switch the gimbal on, because that's what you have to do. So what I'm gonna do is take the camera and slide it into the slot here at the top, the camera slot, and it should slide in pretty easily. Sometimes it doesn't, sometimes it takes a little bit of work, yeah, it's just a question of getting used to it, honestly. So this gimbal is finally pretty much balanced. The last stage would be to hook on the little cable here, and this is pretty straightforward. The cable just attaches to the camera and to the gimbal itself, and then once that's done, you can switch on the gimbal, you can switch on the camera, and you're pretty much good to go. You just have to make sure you calibrate it. So yeah, thank you very much. I hope you all enjoyed this video. I hope you liked sort of like the first part where I was explaining my video settings and then finally the gimbal setup very briefly. But thank you for sticking around if you have. Once again, do consider subscribing. All social links will be left in the description. And yeah, stay tuned for the next one. Peace, guys.